We now move on to an even more insightful session with Mr. Rohit Ohri, Chairman and CEO, FCB Group India. Mr. Rohit Ohri is the Chairman and CEO of FCB Group India, one of IPG's leading agencies in India. He's been the driving force behind the agency's cultural and creative transformation in the past years. Under Rohit's leadership, the agency has consistently been winning top honors at the prestigious global creativity festivals, including One Show, CLIO, LIA, the Andes, D&AD, Spikes, and of course, Cannes. It has become one of the most well-awarded Indian agencies in many prestigious national and international forums. The agency was most recently named the number one agency in India in Campaign Brief Asia Rankings 2021 and Cannes Lions 2021 awarded Agency of the Year at the Campaign Asia Agency of the Year Awards 2020. But all the awards and recognition are only just testimony to Rohit's deep passion for game-changing ideas that not only build brands from scratch with purpose for the agency's clients, but also transform our communities, societies, and the world at large. No wonder then that Rohit is recognized as one of the top 10 most influential in Indian advertising. He was also named India's most inspirational leader in advertising by WCRC, and most recently he was named to Influential Leaders of New India 2021 by CNN News 18, and in another event he was recognized as India's best 50 Marketing and Communication Leaders 2021 by White Page International. Well, can we please have a big round of applause for Mr. Rohit Ohri, Chairman and CEO, FCB Group India. Come on, ladies and gentlemen, louder. He will be sharing insights with us on how to create emotional connect with customers.
Hi, good evening, everybody. And, you know, that was a really long and boring introduction. I'm sorry for that. But I hope you can all hear me. What I'm really going to talk about today is something I'm quite passionate about, is really creating emotional connections with consumers. And today, you know, what we heard just now in the panel as well, digital is really the big new world in which branding and communication needs to work. And the whole idea is that in this new world, what is the importance of emotion and connections? So, you know, we've talked about a lot about social content and social media advertising. But in my view, what has really happened is that, you know, lots of brands, this was, you know, when Facebook, Google, Amazon, you know, Apple, and all these brands came into the world, people thought, you know, there was a transformation going to happen in the world of branding, and brands could move directly into, you know, connecting with consumers, and that would be the new mantra. So you wouldn't need to, the traditional media, you could actually pole vault over that and connect with consumers directly. But what has actually happened is, in my view, a lot of advertising pollution, because what brands have started doing is actually putting in digital messages in the world, right? So you have content, and we've heard a lot of people talk about digital content. Digital content is actually in the current usage, and that's the way I see a lot of brands actually using it. It's a vestige of the past. It's the old, you know, television film reformatted for the digital age, which is not the whole context of how you have to connect and create you know, create emotional bonding with consumers in the digital age. So as a result, there's so much of this content today. You know, if you just look around, every brand thinks of two things. One is either you get a tear in the eye of your consumer, So you have these all these social messages and old people and connecting with them and bring a tear to the eye of the consumer and that's the way you create content and emotional content, you know. So that I think is really the big fundamental problem. And with with this whole power in the hands of consumers to actually skip advertising, where they can choose what they want to watch and what they don't want to watch, this is really a big challenge for us. Is in this environment, how do you actually build consumer connect? How do you actually build that emotion that we are talking about for brands in this environment? I had 20 minutes. I wanted to make one point to you guys just to make sure that there's at the end of it, I always write a presentation in the sense that it's always about that one thing you want to leave consumers with. Pretty much, I don't want to create pollution in your heads with lots of ideas and lots of things. What I'm saying is that, you know, culture is the way you think, act, and interact today, right? So it's increasingly important for brands to not be cultural mutes, right? So the whole thing is that brands don't have a point of view on how to connect on a cultural platform. And today, I think if you can use culture and you can use that in a really interesting way, and I'll show you four examples of how this has been done by our agency, you get an idea of what really we are talking about. What we're saying is majority of the brands today are cultural mutes. You know, just creating content is not the platform on which you can, stir up emotions or create an emotional connect. What we're saying is focus not on the platforms. I mean, it's not about an obsessive focus on this platform. I need to be on that platform. What you need to focus on is the real locus of digital power, which is crowd cultures, right? How do you actually link your brand to a crowd culture? What I mean by crowd culture is really at one point in time, a crowd culture formed from a marginalized, you know, so the real outliers actually had the culture and then they relied on brands and media to actually make that mass. Today, that's not the case. How culture is built is completely changed. Thanks to obviously digital and digital transformation. So what has really happened is that everyone, especially in people who are, you know, the evangelists at the periphery, actually are very digitally connected and they are being able to, you know, spread their message strong and fast across the digital ecosystem. So it's very important for us to figure out how do you link a brand and a brand's world to a crowd culture. What's the bridge that you need to create? And what I'm saying is that if you look at it, there are, I've identified these as four principles, right? So this is really the four principles of cultural branding, which is another word for creating emotional and connecting emotionally with consumers on the cultural platform. So really about, those words are getting cut there. Map the cultural orthodox, right? So the fact is that what you do is, if you want to use culture and you want to use and create this whole crowd culture, there are four things that, what in my experience, really work. Is first identify what is the cultural orthodoxy in the area that you want to talk to with consumers. So whether it is the world that they live in or the world that they influence, what is that orthodox piece there? Locate the cultural opportunity, because what brands are doing, and every brand wants to be progressive. So what you do is you look at that orthodoxy and say that I want to stand at the other end of that. I want to break and I want to create a new way, a new progressive point of view. So I stand against the cultural orthodoxy. I target the crowd culture, saying that, you know, from here, if I stand for this in a genuine manner, if I'm relevant and useful, then I'll be able to create a bridge between people who believe like this and my brand as well. So there's an authenticity in the way I work. So people who believe in that authentic purpose will naturally propagate the brand that is looking to do this. And then through this process, diffuse this new ideology to a whole set of people. So the first example that I want to give you, and if you just remember these four things that I was talking about in from a cultural perspective, if you look at this, this was a campaign that we did 4 years back for the Times of India, right? So the context was really that the Times of India came to us saying that, you know, they wanted to connect with people in West Bengal. And the people in West Bengal actually had the affinity for Telegraph, which was the mother, and it was always the paper there, and they always thought of Times of India as the North Indian newspaper. And anyone who's from Calcutta, I've been born and brought up there, know that Bengalis shun the North Indians like plague, right? So the whole thing was, how do you actually then become and they wanted to do this whole campaign in during pujas. So like I said, was, you know, we looked at cultural orthodoxy and said that let's look at the ceremonies around puja and see that what is the orthodoxy there. And we came up with this very interesting thing called Sindur Khela. Now Sindur Khela is basically where, during Durga Puja, the last day, women apply vermilion on their faces and on the faces of the other women in the community, but it's only married women, right? So the orthodoxy there was, if you're a widow, or if you're a divorcee, or if you're a trans, or if you're, you don't have a husband's name attached to yours, then you cannot play this, right? So we said that this was a 400-year-old tradition. It is no longer relevant. And as a brand, we wanted to stand against that cultural orthodoxy and said that we want to stand for a new progressive mindset. And you know, when I was talking about the this whole cultural groups that we wanted to actually talk to, then here we wanted to talk to the progressive Bengalis, right? So we addressed that whole crowd of people who believed that they were progressive Bengalis, and they adopted this whole message and said, this speaks to us. So have a look at the film. There's no audio here, Priyanka. Can you rewind it, please?
Happen. stop this. Either maybe in the Tridhara Shango or any Shango or without any Shango. But we'll never stop this.
So this was a really powerful, this is one of the most awarded campaigns globally in 2018. And, you know, the amazing thing was that it was not, you know, when I talk about, you know, cultural orthodoxy, this was really the smashing a cultural orthodoxy. And that's what, you know, if you look at it, why Sindoor Khela succeeded was not because it was great content, because actually the brief was to create content on digital, but what it was a strategy that smashed this whole cultural orthodoxy. And the fantastic piece of this is that Times of India no longer supports this, but this is something that the puja pandals in Calcutta have adopted, and now this is a practice, right? So this fifth year in running that they actually invite all women to come and participate in Sindoor Khela, right? I think I've run out of time. I just wanted to show you one more piece, which was really this whole thing of Sridhan, where, you know, looking at from a culture lens again, and looking at what is tradition and changing that. So have a look at the ad and then we'll talk about it.
India is the biggest buyer of gold in the world. Every year, millions flock to jewelry stores on the day of Dhanteras to buy gold. But in 2019, Project Sridhan changed a 500-year-old tradition. On Dhanteras, instead of telling women to buy gold, we told women to invest in iron. DSM presents Project Sridhan. Sridhan translates to the wealth of a woman. And in India, while women indulge in gold, their bodies starve for another metal, iron. One out of two women suffer from anemia. To get women to pay attention to their iron, we launched a film that told them that it's just as sexy to fortify yourself as it is to beautify yourself. And in a matter of days, our film went viral. Even across platforms where we weren't present. Captivated by our message, actors, influencers, and eventually thousands of women across the world joined our iron intervention.
I promise to invest in my real dhan.
Go get yourself tested and eat healthy food.
It's time that we also invest in a healthier future.
And I encourage all ladies to invest in iron.
To further play into women's desire for jewelry, we designed iron-fortified jewelry and sent it to over 300 influencers and bloggers. 50 of the biggest jewelry brands joined us and showcased our edible jewelry in their showrooms on Dhanteras.
We'll get a complimentary piece of necklace.
Our contextual message hit home. We were not just extensively covered by the media, our message was also amplified by the government and international bodies. By hijacking an age-old tradition, India for the first time ever heard a different message on Dhanteras. This Dhanteras, invest in iron.
So, you know, the thing was when we told our client DSM that we wanted to actually do this in jewelry stores, he just couldn't believe that, you know, you could actually, you know, give a message for iron and, you know, anemia to women in a jewelry store. But this was really, you know, it's really about looking at, you know, when you identify a cultural orthodoxy, the other point I was talking about, looking at opportunities, and this was an opportunity and a place where we could actually give our message to consumers. And the interesting thing is, in today's day and age, if you want to connect on that emotional platform, find the right place that you want that message to be given to them. And women were surprised, you know. I mean, they all come there to buy gold, and suddenly they're getting edible jewelry, saying, you know, and the message suddenly struck, saying that, why am I investing in gold when I can have, I should be actually having iron, which will turn gold inside me, right? So that really is the big one message that I wanted to leave you with. I this is the first time I've kind of, there's a negative 4.34 showing on the screen. So with that, thank you so much. Thank you very much.